The beer du jour is Grandpa's Sweater Oatmeal Stout. From Barnhammer Brewing in Winnipeg, this is just a very nice, rich, smooth stout. One of my favorites. So now that it's December, as promised, I am going to do a whole bunch of kit builds. I think that should be a nice holiday sort of a thing. And today I've got these two kits that were sent in by Patrick from Quebec. A small Canadian seller that's got some interesting products. Why wouldn't I help the guy out? So, yeah, I think I'm going to try and be greedy and do two of these in the same video, because they're both small beginner level kits. They've only got, you know, half a dozen components per kit, so it should be fairly doable, I think. And this first one is a Joule Thief kit. He calls it a Joule Thief build kit with swivel fridge magnets. So that should be fun. And the other one, well, we'll get to that in a bit. So let's dump all these parts out and see what we've got. Now, I took a look at it when I was doing the mailbag that this thing initially showed up in, but that's been a few weeks. So we have these two 3D printed bits. That one is, looks like a AA battery holder. And this one also clips onto the AA battery when it's like that. And then that is the fridge magnet part. Except for that's stainless. Where's something actually steel? There we go. That just holds the whole thing on there, and then the circuit board mounts there. It's an interesting idea. I don't think I've ever seen that form factor done before. So in addition to this little circuit board, nice heavy thick circuit board, two black solder mask and white screen printing on there. So in addition to that, there's a couple of different bits of wire here, two shorter ones that you're supposed to use to make the battery terminals, and this one that you're supposed to wrap your own inductor. This part right here, this little bit of a wooden stick, little bamboo cooking skewer actually, that confused me when I first opened this, but it's actually a form to wind your own inductor around. That's pretty slick. A little power switch, a little transformer on a ferrite ring. So it's just like a one-to-one transformer. And I think that's a standard part of the Joule Thief circuit. We'll take a look at the schematic in a second here, but I'm pretty sure that's a standard part. And then we have four LEDs, a single resistor, and a single transistor. So the Joule Thief is just a classic little circuit. And you know it's a classic circuit when it's got its own Wikipedia page. Talks about the circuit being around since the 1930s. So you can read this on your own later. I'm not going to go through all the theory of operation. I'll put a link to this Wikipedia page in the description. But here is the schematic. Super duper simple. We have a battery. We have a resistor. We have a transformer. Notice these dots. Those indicate the direction of winding of the transformer. So the two coils, one is wound from one end to the other of the ferrite, and this one is wound the opposite direction. And this one with the resistor in series goes to the base of the transistor. The other winding goes to the collector side. The collector side also goes to the LED, to the positive side of the LED, and the emitter and the negative side of the LED and the negative of the battery all go together. Now, what makes this magical is that this battery is lower than the voltage that this LED needs. So where the magic happens is in the oscillations that are set up between this transformer and this transistor down here. When the magnetic field in the secondary side, let's call it the secondary, of this transformer collapses, that gives enough of a kick of voltage to light up the LED at a voltage higher than what the battery has. Because that inductive kick, whatever that voltage is in series with the battery. So here we have it. JP1 is the markings on the board where the battery goes. JP1 is the positive side, JP2 is the negative side. We have the four LEDs in parallel down here. as we saw, the collector goes to the positive side of the LEDs and the emitter goes to the negative side of the LEDs. The base goes through a resistor. It was on the other side of the transformer, but whatever. Here is the transformer, and I've drawn it how it physically is. The two windings are wound together, so to get them that sort of inverse winding thing, it just crosses over from one side to the other. The only difference is this extra inductor here, which is the hand-wound one, is in series with the, or between the transformer and the LEDs. So I'm assuming that just gives it a little bit more of an inductive kick to have a little bit more of a boost to the voltage to these things. But that's enough of that. Oh, let's get to building. Now, this is the little sheet of paper that comes with the kit. So it shows hand winding that coil, which goes onto here in this position. And it also shows winding the bits of wire around the ends of this battery holder to form the terminals. So I think I'll do that later, though. I'll solder the rest of the stuff down first. So I think I'm just going to go through the standard type components and solder them in quickly, because I'm sure that's not the most entertaining part. It's just simply soldering. But once we get to the interesting stuff and the unusual stuff, I'll slow down and bring you along for the ride. Okay, that's all the basic components done. Now then, this inductor, or coil as you prefer. So he's given us this length of wire. Looks like about 29 centimeters long. With instructions to just wrap a tight coil around this bamboo skewer. Is this enameled wire? I'm not sure. I didn't actually check. He doesn't show them the windings as touching in the picture. They look like they're slightly spaced out, so I may have to do that. I have wrapped it tight now. I can't get it off the stick. It's been a long time since I've wound my own inductors for anything. This is kind of neat. Okay. That's on there, I think. The other slick trick about this is winding this battery holder. So you stick about 2 centimeters of wire through there, bend it at a 90, wrap the other end around a couple of times by the looks of it, and then down through the board. Okay, so about 2 centimeters sticking out there, bend that at a 90, and then this just wraps around a couple of times. Interesting. Spin that guy around. That is a whole new level of DIY. I like it. That is very old school. I mean, except for the fact that it's 3D printed, of course. That fits on there rather clever. I like that. And hopefully I don't throw so much heat at this that it melts the 3D printed part on the other side. That ought to be it, ready to go. Now then, what did I say from my schematic? JP1 is the positive side, JP2 is the negative side. Okay. I think I'm just going to mark that positive end, just so that I don't forget or have to refigure it out every single time. Those are making contact. Oh man, Are they making contact? Or did I put it in backwards? I couldn't have figured it out backwards, could I have? So now I have to diagnose this. Man. Okay, I found the problem. And actually, it was two problems. That was one of them. I had the positive on the wrong end. Fortunately, I didn't blow anything up. But the other problem is this little switch here. When I short the switch, everything works. So this little switch is the problem. But I can fix that. There. Now the switch is no longer a problem. But it works. It works. It works. And then the last part of the kit is this little magnet bit here. And you can stick it onto something, anything, magnetic. Like that. That's pretty darn cool. I guess let's put it onto something vertical. Sure. Here we go. LED fridge magnet. A Joule Thief fridge magnet. Very neat. Okay, that's kit one done. With only a little bit of headache. Let's carry on to the second kit, shall we? Okay, the second kit is this little one. It is a sine wave generator using a 555 timer in a stable mode. It apparently creates a square wave and then goes through an LC network tank circuit, an inductive capacitive tank circuit. It just resonates at a specific frequency. And it creates a sine wave out of that. He says there's no real use for this other than learning, but that's a good use as it is. So let's see what all's in here. As with the other one, not too much. Got the same high quality feeling circuit board. We have an inductor, 555, of course. We have three capacitors, two of one type and one of the other. A resistor and a couple of header pins. And the capacitors are marked on there. Oh, there's three different ones. There's a 105, a 103, and a 104. Okay. But they are marked. The resistors are 2.5K. The inductor goes there. Yeah, nothing to it. So there's the standard A-stable circuit. We have a voltage divider there. On the discharge pin, we have a capacitor. There's the timing capacitor. This control pin is just being held close to ground, or well, ground-ish with a capacitor. Ground, we have the trigger and threshold inputs together. We have the reset held high, and we have an output on pin 3. So how this guy works, basically, this capacitor charges through these two resistors. There's a voltage divider inside here for 1/3 and 2/3 of voltage. So when this hits the trigger threshold, it switches the output, which turns the discharge on, which discharges the capacitor through this resistor. And when it hits the lower threshold, it turns the output off and starts recharging the capacitor through the pair of resistors. So by changing the ratio of these two resistors, you can change the frequency. By changing the relationship between the capacitor and the resistors, you can change the frequency. Or by changing the relationship between those three components, you can also change the duty cycle. And there's all kinds of math to figure it out. I usually just do it experimentally, roughly anyways, starting with some general values. So here is a quick and dirty schematic of what we've got going on here. So we have power and ground coming in. We have the trigger and threshold strapped together as usual. We have, but there, here's the timing components, which makes it a little bit different. Got a capacitor down here and a resistor, and then this is the LC tank circuit, which is creating, which has its own resonant frequency, so that will be sort of filtering out all the high frequency stuff and just leaving us with the fundamental frequency. So a square wave, which this thing produces naturally, is a whole mix of frequencies. It's the fundamental frequency and then a whole bunch of harmonics. So by using this tank circuit to essentially filter out all those higher frequency harmonics, we're just left with the fundamental frequency. And again, I could do the math on these to figure it out, but I'm not going to. I'm going to do it experimentally. That's just how I like to do things. Okay, we got the itty bitty board in the board holder. Let's just start throwing components at it and see what happens, starting with the resistor. I think the hardest part of this one is just going to be getting capacitors in the right spot. But they're marked. That one is marked 104. Goes there. That one's marked 103. So it goes there. And the other one, by process of elimination, is lost on the bench here. It says 683, but that says 105. So I wonder how much of a difference is going to be between a 10 nanofarad capacitor and a 68 nanofarad capacitor. Maybe I'll try it with the components that are provided. And if that doesn't work properly, I will replace it with one of my own. I intentionally left that one sitting high so I can grab it later if I have to. Right, what's left? Just the chip and the header pins. These very standard header pins. Just snap them off. Two for the power input and two for the output. And that's it. Done. Ugly soldering and all. No, it's not. Not even close to done. What am I thinking? Inductor. Pins are splayed ever so slightly from where the holes are on the board. That's okay. It just means it's got a tight fit. And last, the chip. Now, normally, I would want to socket a chip because I don't want to damage it. But these things are rugged. Those pins are a little bit... Hey, fortunately, I have a fancy custom-made tool to deal with that. There we go. Fits like a glove. As usual, though, I am spreading the heat around, soldering one side, then the other. Again, these 555s aren't all that fragile. It's just good practice to keep the heat spread around. Okay, let's put some power onto this guy. 5 volts and ground. Get on there. And just for fun, let's clamp the silly scope on there. You already knew that I had it running because you could probably hear its fans going in the background, right? Got 5 volts on there and a current limit set to about 300 milliamps just in case. And power on. Okay, 14, 19 milliamps, nothing significant. Okay, good. So let's take a look over at the scope. Oh, hey, it's a sine wave. A very nice looking sine wave, too. It's a little fuzzy looking because my scope is old and not perfect, but it looks like about 16 kilohertz, doesn't it? That's pretty neat. And yeah, that is a fairly smooth looking sine wave. Just for fun, and because I didn't actually try it with this meter when I was testing it, let's see if it can read that frequency. 15.7 kilohertz. Huh, that's pretty close to what I was showing on the scope, wasn't it? Nothing like building a couple of kits to keep you warm on a winter's night. Well, thanks for watching. I hope you enjoyed that, found that entertaining or informative or something. Thanks to Patrick once again for sending me these to play with. I do appreciate that. Any comments or questions any of you have down below in the comment section as usual. I will talk to you later.